Hello, my name is Michelle Bachman. I am the Dean of the Robertson School of Government in Regent University, and that prevents me from being with you in person today. I want to thank you for the kind invitation to join you. I know all of you who are here this evening are here because you love the Jewish state, you love the Jewish people. Most of all, you embrace the truths of God's Word. And that's what I want to speak about with our few minutes that we have together this evening. I've been very impressed lately, as we have for the last 10 months or so in this nation, looked at the difference. It seems like an attack, a direct frontal attack that has come upon our nation in so many different ways. And as we are somewhat bewildered, somewhat perplexed, and yet at the same time casting about trying to understand what is happening in our nation and what is happening in Israel, we're looking at two nations as recently as January 28th of 2020 that were flying high. They were flying high. They were soaring. It was good times with the political leadership, and it was great times in the nation. And literally almost overnight, it seemed that both the United States and Israel, politically, as well as economically, as well as with the health of the nation, just completely changed. And it's like the rug fell out from under them. And what was it? I have been thinking about that and ruminating on this for some time. And in recent weeks, I've come across several scriptures that I want to share with you. I want to say, first of all, I'm not a theologian. That is not my background. I just want to share with you from my heart, my opinion, a few thoughts about where we are today and what my thoughts are both for Israel and for the United States. And I would begin, if any of you have your Bible with you or if you want to pull up YouVersion on your app, I'm in Isaiah 22. And this is really a sobering conversation that we're having this weekend. Isaiah 22. This is a message from the prophet Isaiah, and it was about Jerusalem, also called the Valley of Vision. In this, it's a tragic, terrible time. And in some ways, this scripture that I'm giving you now should precede the second scripture I'll be giving you, because this is the tragedy. This is the aftermath of the tragedy that came upon Jerusalem. And God is giving a message and speaking to the prophet Isaiah, and he is speaking that message out. But actually, I think this is the right place to give this scripture, because Isaiah is saying, bodies are everywhere. The city's in a terrible uproar. What do I see in this city? People that weren't killed in battle, they're killed by famine. They're killed by diseases. Israel was in an uproar. Jerusalem, particularly, was in an uproar. Verse 3, all your leaders have fled. They surrendered without resistance. The people were trying to give away, get away out of the city. And Isaiah said, let me cry for my people. I'm watching them be destroyed. Verse 5, oh, what a day of crushing defeat. What a day of confusion and terror brought by the Lord. The day of crushing defeat, the day of confusion was brought by the Lord of heaven's armies upon the Valley of Vision, Jerusalem. And then it goes on to say that the walls of Jerusalem were broken down. The cries of death were echoing from the mountainsides. Archers, chariots, charioteers, foreigners holding up their shields. Chariots filled your beautiful valley. Charioteers stormed your gates. It was a horrible scene that Isaiah is describing. And then what was the response from Judah? Their defenses were stripped away, so what did they try to do? They ran to the armory for their weaponry. They inspected the breaks in the walls of Jerusalem. They stored up water in the lower pool. In other words, they had set up defenses knowing that this terror was going to come. You surveyed your houses. You tore them down for stones to strengthen your walls. And even between the city walls, you built a reservoir for water so they could survive from the old pool. But listen to this, verse 11. But you never ask for help from the one who did this all to you. I'm going to read that again. But you never ask for help from the one who did all this. So they saw the terror coming. They saw that they were about to be attacked. They created their defenses. But the one thing they forgot to do is they failed to ask for help from God, the one who did all this, this terror. You never considered the one who planned this long ago. How could that even be? God planned this destruction long ago? Yet this is the word of the Lord to Isaiah that he gave. Verse 12, at that time, long ago, the Lord of heaven's armies, called you to weep and mourn. When God planned this destruction upon the Valley of Vision, Jerusalem, he called the people in that city to weep and mourn. He told you to shave your heads in sorrow for your sins and to wear clothes of burlap to show your remorse. Is that what the people did in Jerusalem? No. Verse 13 says, but instead, you dance and play. You slaughter cattle, you kill sheep, you feast on meat and drink wine. You say, let's feast and drink, for tomorrow we die. You see, the people in Jerusalem knew what was coming. They knew that destruction was coming to them. And so they built up defenses, but yet then consult God about this, or weep and mourn for their own sins to look internally. They said, look, we see what's coming. We see bad times are coming to our society and our city. So instead of putting on burlap, weeping, mourning, turning to God, instead, what did they do? Let's eat and drink. Let's spend everything we have, because tomorrow we're going to die anyway. So we're going to look to ourselves, not to the one who made us. And so then God said, the Lord of heaven's armies revealed this to me, till the day you die, you will never be forgiven for this sin. And what was that sin? When the people saw that destruction was coming, and they well knew it, they turned to themselves and their own devices. They continued to have a party. They continued to feed the own desires of their hearts rather than looking to God. And the Lord of heaven's army said, till the day you die, you will never be forgiven for this sin, for not turning to God, for turning to yourselves. That is the judgment of the Lord of heaven's armies. There's so much more in that scripture, but as I was reading this and contemplating on this, the Lord took me also to 2 Kings 22. That was Isaiah 22. This is 2 Kings 22. This is the great story that many of us love, because in 2 Kings, we read about one evil king after another. It seemed like very rarely was there a good king that followed after God's own heart. But in 2 Kings 22, there is a good king who comes after many, many bad kings. And it's young Josiah, who was 8 years old. He was 31 years a king. But this is what the scripture says of Josiah. He did what was pleasing in the Lord's sight. He followed the example of his ancestor David. He did not turn away from doing what was right. What did he do? And what did we know about this society? It's almost unimaginable. This is ancient Israel. The Lord's temple is there. And Josiah is thinking about the temple. He's wanting to bring back the temple. He's wanting to get it built up again. And so what does he do? Here he takes and he pulls the money together, because there were taxes in those days. And he sent his court scribe to Hilkiah, the high priest. And he said, have Hilkiah count the money that the gatekeepers all collected. Let's use it to restore the Lord's temple. And unbeknownst to Josiah, Hilkiah, the high priest, said to the court secretary, and this is in verse 8, I found the book of the law in the Lord's temple. Now, well, of course, wouldn't the book of the law be Lord's temple? Absolutely. But clearly this book hadn't been consulted for a very long time. The kings prior to this had their own way. They turned away from God's law completely. But Hilkiah said, I found the book of the law in the Lord's temple. And then he gave the scroll to the court secretary. So Hilkiah read the law. He gave the book of the law to the court secretary. The court secretary read the law. And then the court secretary went to King Josiah, and he said, your officials have turned over the money collected at the temple of the Lord to the workers and supervisors at the temple. That's exactly what the king sent the court secretary to do. But then the court secretary also told the king, Hilkiah, the high priest, has given me a scroll. So the court secretary read it to the king. Hilkiah had read the law and was reminded of the truth. He gave it to the court secretary. He read the law, was reminded of the truth, and then he read it to King Josiah. And when the king heard, this is now verse 11 of chapter 22, 2 Kings. When the king heard what was written in the book of the law, he tore his clothes in despair. Remember in Isaiah 22? That's what God said to the people of Israel. This is what you should do. Tear your clothes in despair. You need to put on burlap. You need to weep. You need to mourn over your sin. In other words, you've been so far removed from me. It isn't that God just wants to see us wear burlap and moan and cry. It's that what God wants us to do is look at our heart, look at our ways, look at our lack of obedience, look at our lack of relationship with Him. Ultimately, that's what it's all about. It's God the Redeemer bringing us back to Him in obedience so we will have relationship and communication with Him and communion with Him that was lacking in Israel. The people had turned so far away from the things of God. But what the king did in response to hearing what was written in the book of law, remember, he was already a man who was after David's heart in that same pattern. He tore his clothes in despair. And then he gave these orders to the high priest and to the others in his court. And he said in verse 13, go to the temple and speak to the Lord for me, the king, and for the people, and for all of Judah, all Israel at that time. Inquire about the words that were written in the scroll, that is essentially Deuteronomy, that has been found. For the Lord's great anger is burning against us, Israel, the Jewish people, because our ancestors have not obeyed the words in this scroll. We have not been doing everything that it said that we must do. And so then they went to visit a prophet to ask the prophet what they should do. The prophet said to them, the Lord says, I'm going to bring disaster on this city and its people. In other words, the book of Deuteronomy would come true because God had said in his book that there will be blessings for Israel, there'll be cursings for Israel based upon their level of obedience to the law of God. Clearly, Israel had been grossly disobedient to the things of God. So God said, I am going to have my nature through my holiness. I am going to bring about disaster on this city, just as the Bible says. All the words written in this scroll that the king of Judah has read will come true. It will happen. God is just, and his justice will one day be revealed. And he said, this is why, in verse 17, for my people have abandoned me. They offered sacrifices to pagan gods, and I am very angry with them for everything they have done. You see, the worst thing we can do is not worship God, but worship something that is a replacement for God, a false god, anything else. My anger will burn against this place and will not be quenched. Verse 18, but go to the king of Judah who sent you to seek the Lord and tell him. So tell King Josiah, this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says concerning the message you've just heard. This is now to Josiah, who wanted to do right by God, who, when he heard the word of God and saw that Israel had grossly disobeyed and grossly sinned and had turned away from God and was not in right relationship with God, Josiah's immediate response was to believe the word of God. That God is who he says he is, that the word of God is what it says it is. He believed God, he saw the lack of disobedience, and so he rightly responded with weeping and sorrow and tearing his clothing because he understood that he needed to repent. It was repentance and turning back to God on the part of Josiah. But go to the king, tell him, this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says concerning the message you've heard. You were sorry and humbled yourself before the Lord when you heard what I said against this city, Jerusalem, and its people, that this land would become cursed and desolate. You tore your clothing in despair. You wept before me in repentance. And I've indeed heard you, says the Lord. So the Lord is saying to King Josiah, so I won't send the promised disaster until after you've died and then buried in peace. You won't see the disaster that I'm going to bring to this city. So they took this message back to Josiah. You see, Josiah did exactly what the Lord said to Isaiah in chapter 22. He said, this is the right response. Weep, mourn, tear your clothes in recognition that you have sinned against me in thought, word, deed. You are separate from me. You are no longer worshiping me. You're worshiping a false god, whether that's the god of self. We worship ourself and our own desires, whether we worship some other false god, some other false idols in our life. In other words, it is false. It is not the God of the Bible. King Josiah had the right response. In the middle of the situation that they were in and all the gross sin that Israel had committed, ultimately God is just. Ultimately God is holy. And there would be a day of reckoning. I think today now of Israel, and I think today now of the United States of America and where we are. Gross sin has been committed in our nation. Gross sin has been committed in the nation of Israel by the American people, by the Jewish people. I'm not talking about all other nations of the world. I'm just talking about our two nations right now. And what is our response to be? In particular, in this last year, we've seen the United States almost spin out of control, out of the orbit. It's like God set up the moon and stars and orbits. And it's like the United States has spun out of control. It's like Israel has spun out of control. And so what should our response be? It's always been the same thing, according to the Word of God. It's always been when you recognize that you have spun out of control, what you need to do is weep, mourn, put on your burlap, tear your clothes. For what reason? For this reason, to return to God. To return to his word. That is true obedience. The word says to obey is better than sacrifice. To obey him, to return to him. In the case of Josiah, he literally wanted to do what was right before God. And God, in his grace and in his mercy, he gave yet a little more time before the destruction would come. Again, Josiah was eight before he became king. He ruled and reigned for 31 more years. He didn't have a long, long life, but what he did have, God gave him a blessing in the land for that period of time. And then there was the destruction. Then there was the judgment. We cannot think that the United States will escape judgment. We won't. We can't think that Israel will escape judgment. It won't. When we are not obedient or walking in the ways of God or making God first, there is a judgment that comes. Why does God do that? Because Psalms 23 tells us, he pursues us with unfailing love. It's because he loves us, not because he's sitting up in some faraway throne and he just loves to throw lightning bolts at it. No, 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 no. This is a personal, loving God who has always wanted relationship with his chosen people, but with all people. That's where we come in. He sacrificed himself for us. He humbled himself, God himself, came to this earth in the image and likeness of a man and lived a perfect sinless life and paid the price for the sins for all of us that we have all committed. Why? So that we could come back into relationship with him. And when he ascended to heaven, he left his Holy Spirit to be on this earth so that we were never without him. Again, the 23rd Psalm. He pursues us with his unrelenting love, and he pursues us with his faithfulness to the point where he says, our cup overflows with goodness. So this isn't a tragedy. This is actually a love story that I'm telling us this morning. There's tragedy in Isaiah 11, the tragedy of a society pulling apart, falling apart to the point of being taken away into captivity. And also with 2 Kings, tragedy, knowing that a day of reckoning would come, that just accounts would be kept. But the true story in all of this is a holy God, a wonderful God who loves us, who gave himself for us, who has redeemed us and brought himself back to himself. Within our lifetimes, we've seen the greatest miracle of prophecy come through. That is the rebirth of the modern Jewish state, as the prophets all foretold. We've also seen in our lifetime Jerusalem come back into Israel's hand in 1967. We're seeing prophecy fulfilled day and night in front of our eyes. And so what a time, like Josiah, to come back to the things of God, to make sure that it begins with us, that we, like Josiah, have a personal recognition of the gross sin in our own lives and in the lives of our community and the lives of our nation, and that we return to God. Not that we stay in a constant state of crying bitter tears, but to do that until we get to the point of coming back in relationship with God. That's what we need to be. So I would ask that you would join me now in prayer for Israel, the Jewish people, for America, for the people of our nation, that we too would wake up and heed the warning that God gave through Isaiah, that judgment does come, that our right response to a time of turmoil and tragedy is to turn to him. And like Josiah, actually do that and see the grace and mercy that God brings. I don't know that God will stay his hand the way that he did for King Josiah, but I do know this: there is no better response in the midst of tragedy than to truly repent and to truly obey and truly turn to him, because no one can outlove us like the Creator who made us. So join me right now. Father, you are the God of Israel. Lord, you are the one who created all people in all places. You established all nations and the boundaries. Oh, Father, you are the author and finisher of our faith. I thank you, oh God, that our times are in your hands. And so, too, we thank you, oh God, for what you spoke through the prophet Isaiah. We see the tragedy, Lord, of your people rejecting you in the midst of tragedy and embracing themselves and their own entertainment in the midst of tragedy. And tragedy came. And we see Josiah, King Josiah, when confronted, Lord, living in a sea of ignorance at that time, but when confronted with the truth, running to you and running to the truth and running to obedience. Oh God, I pray that all of us would have a heart like David and a heart like Josiah, that we would see the sin in our own lives, see the sin in our community, see the sin in our nation. And instead of running away to satisfy ourselves while we watch our society collapse around us, that instead, oh God, we would, for ourselves, for our community, for our nation, that we would repent. And so, Father, we come to you now as proxies. We repent first of our own sin. We repent for the gross immorality in our communities. We repent, oh God, for the gross immorality and the ways that we've deviated from your standard in our nation and also in Israel. And so, Father, we don't judge. We're not judging. Instead, it's just quite the opposite. We're tearing our clothes. We're putting on the sackcloth, putting on the mourning, and weeping before you, O God, and asking for your forgiveness. So that's where we're at, Father. We come to you for forgiveness, but we also receive your forgiveness in our persons. We receive your forgiveness for ourselves. We receive your forgiveness for our community. We receive your forgiveness for our nation. But we also pray, Father, that your word would go forth. There was gross ignorance in Israel because they failed to pick up your word. They failed to know your word. They failed to heed your word. And we are no different. We are no different than ancient Israel. In a time we have more access to your word, it's a time when we fail to heed your word like never before. And so we lift that gross sin up to you and we receive your forgiveness in repentance. So I thank you for that, Father. I thank you for being with this meeting today, with all of those who have spoken, with all of those who are gathered. Hear the cry of our heart. Heed us, Lord, when we call. We thank you, Father, for your redemption now. In your mighty name we pray. Amen.